for many years I've had a hobby I'm quite passionate about, and it's coffee. I can hardly imagine starting my day without a cup of coffee. A few years ago, I started having coffee beans sent to me from Ethiopia and roasting them myself by hand. I simply wanted to have as much influence as possible on the ultimate taste. Over time, I grew increasingly curious about the country my coffee beans coming from. I began to dream of going there and exploring the landscape that produces these very coffee beans. In November 2011, I finally persuaded my wife Ramona to accompany me to Ethiopia. On our motorcycles, of course, which has been our preferred method of travel for many years.
The aroma of freshly roasted coffee fills the small shack. Here in Ethiopia, coffee is always made fresh. The beans are roasted on an open fire and then crushed in a wooden mortar. Coffee grinding is traditionally seen as a woman's work, we are told. I'm curious and want to give it a try. But it's not at all as simple as it looks. Tegi, who is traveling with us as our interpreter, shows me the right technique. Apparently, the rhythm makes the difference. At any rate, it's a strenuous job. And it gives Herbert the opportunity to shoot an entire series of photos of his wife grinding coffee. We are at the Kunga Kabele coffee plantation, near a town called Yirga Chefe, about 400 kilometers south of Addis Abeba. This is where the coffee is grown that we drink at home. That seems to make the people here very happy. The reception we are given is more than cordial.
Welcome to Kunga Kabele.
Thank you.
Okay. We don't just suspect that Ethiopian coffee is the best in the world. We are sure of it. Tegi translates everything into Amharic, the most commonly spoken language in Ethiopia. Meanwhile, the woman of the house is making the coffee. Its tantalizing aroma fills the entire room. Everyone is pleased that we like their coffee so much. We are moved by their spontaneous applause. And before long, we are given a cup of fragrant coffee. After all, it was the main reason we came here.
Wow, that's the coffee I wanted. It's sensational. Worth every kilometer we've traveled.
I too, I'm totally thrilled with the way things have gone. While we drink in silence, the owner of the plantation begins to talk. He says he never thought anyone would come from so far away just to see his plantation and how he works.
To appreciate or give thanks for the government to allow you to come here,
yes,
down to the farmer and to look us. Mm-hmm. And he said, you have done big thing for us to come in my house, in this small house, to go with your food in the farm with me walking on the mud and looking my coffee. Before this, I didn't know that nobody cares about Yirga Chefe coffee. I was thinking it's just a farm in the backyard. But now I know the whole world didn't know about me. So I'm proud that you came here and I give thanks for you. And bless you.
Nice.
We depart Yirga Chefe and head north in the direction of Shashamane.
Many residents of Shashamane are members of the Rastafari movement. In the teachings of the Rastafaris, Ethiopia is considered the Holy Land. The Rastafarian way of life originated in Jamaica. But not all members of the Rastafari movement are from there. Aishiba Tafari of the Yaventa Children's Center is originally from Austria.
It's a daycare center, a school for children living with AIDS and other kids with special needs, especially financial ones. The children aren't here today because it's a Saturday. They attend school here from Monday till Friday and they don't pay a cent. The kids are from poor families and we give them a free education. We have a kindergarten and the first three grades of elementary school so far, and food, four meals every day, as well as medical care.
Außerdem essen jeden Tag viermal und medizinische Betreuung. Wir zahlen für alle medizinischen Kosten.
Aishiba Tefari has been living in Shashamane since 1997. She opened the school in 2008. Medical care and schooling are hard for many people here to afford.
We have a lot of materials, and as I stressed, the teachers have to receive additional training. Here's something you might want to take a quick look at. This is a sleeping room for the children, the small children. The kindergarten kids take their after-lunch nap here on these mats.
The Yaventa Children's Center is the result of Aishiba Tafari's hard efforts. She fought against much resistance to open this school. Since then, she has been trying to increase awareness among the local population for education, healthy nutrition and medical care for children. But where did you get the idea to move here to Ethiopia? Was it while you were still in Europe?
I actually came here to write my master's thesis, but that didn't happen and I just stayed here. I felt that I belong here. Then I went to Addis Ababa for 3 years and taught English at various schools. I enjoyed teaching a lot, so I thought I would like to do something with teaching. And I wanted to work with children. But I wanted to include the HIV aspect for personal reasons, because I know people who are infected with HIV. And I wanted to include that aspect too. And that's how this project came about. I didn't expect it to grow so quickly.
As in many cities in Ethiopia, rickety Bajaj brand three-wheelers, also called tuk-tuks, are the primary means of transportation. With 8 horsepower, 4-stroke engines, they can hold the driver and 2 passengers. More passengers cause no problem for most Africans. We ride through the narrow streets to visit an artist who belongs to the Rastafarian community. Rashailu Tefari has specialized in an art that is relatively unique. He calls himself a banana artist. In his gallery, we gain the impression that banana art is a serious endeavor. Rashailu Tefari makes impressive collages using banana plants. I was impressed by the nuances of color in his works.
Look at this. That this is the thread, the inside. It comes down. Okay. So 3 different textures.
Das vom Stamm, ne? Yeah. That's from the trunk.
Because it comes in different.
Yeah.
Yeah. And another piece. Watch this, the body of the tree. Which is a.
Once again, we are invited for coffee. In Ethiopia, a coffee ceremony takes place whenever people meet. Drinking coffee together is not just part of social and cultural life here. Being invited to a coffee ceremony also means you are a welcome guest whose presence is appreciated. Meanwhile, we learn more about banana art.
I had to drill somewhere else, you know, here. Have more variety than the Caribbean. Ethiopia have more species of banana.
Time to leave Rashailu Tefari and an exciting occasion for little Adam. He wants to ride on one of the motorcycles. His wish will come true. It's not far to the home of our host, Ras Quintesep, Adam's father. But even such a short ride on a motorcycle means a lot to Adam. As always on our travels, we try to park the motorcycles safely for the night. It's not always easy.
We spent the evening with Ras Quintisep and his friends from the Rastafarian community. We are not the only guests from Europe. A young couple from the Ukraine is also visiting. It's a custom to wash your hands before eating, especially since people use their fingers to eat.
Africa films, like Herbert and Ramona.
Yeah, I thought it was our obligation to come back and live permanently because it's what I was searching for. I didn't go to a different part in Africa after this, you know. I found what I was looking for, Rastafari.
You're
good.
Yeah, do you see it before I...
go on. Is everything here? The biggest.
And while we listen to the stories of the Rastafaris, the woman of the house is busy making coffee. We are not quite sure what Ras Quintisep smokes in his impressive pipe, but the smell of it mixes with the aroma of coffee slowly roasting.
The other thing too, in the world, everybody looks at Ethiopia as starved people.
This is another tradition. Guests must sniff the freshly roasted buna. Buna is the Amharic word for coffee.
Red dragon was waiting to deliver to devour the child.
In contrast to the plantation, an electric grinder is used here.
Right on the road is, I would say, okay. Have to be there. If you are there,
incense is also burned during the coffee ceremony, and the various different aromas merge to create an extraordinary fragrance that fills Ras Quintisep's house in Shashamane. A general feeling of well-being encompasses us. A few chords are played on a guitar, and the evening ritual takes its course. Before long, Ras Quintisep picks up the guitar. He's been in the music business since 1974. He has often performed on concert stages in Europe. Tonight, we enjoy a private performance.
Addis Ababa granted a glimpse in revelation on the slopes of Etoto, where the poor and diseased go. Fire glory, Rasta story, it's a visitation. They seen the king riding, king of whom we sing, riding on lions, the fire on Etoto Mountain, riding the monkey to sing, riding on lions, in the fire. On a street corner, at the red traffic light too, the shoe shine boys and fruit vendors are smiling. They're calling out to Rasta, expressing figure too, because like we know now, all your people, you're not just backsliding.
Left with the impressions from Shashamane, we now head north towards Addis Abeba.
Riding on lions in a fire on a turtle mountain. Riding on lions in a fire on a turtle mountain.
In Addis Abeba, we stop for, what else, a coffee break. Although this coffee comes out of a machine, it tastes nearly as good. And then we continue our journey northward. The road is in good shape here, and we are making good time. But soon, we leave the asphalt behind us. We still have many off-road kilometers to travel. Our next destination is the town of Alem Katema, where there are no more asphalt roads. Traffic is heavy on the main road. There are plenty of opportunities to take a break, drink some coffee, or enjoy a snack. I wish I could just stay here and watch. Like every place else in Africa, life is lived outdoors here, on the street. So many impressions, and hardly enough time to take it all in. We stock up for the dirt road, with coffee, tea, Coke, and injera, a sourdough flatbread used to wrap meat or vegetables. Injera is a typical Ethiopian food, but not everyone likes it.
Thank you.
After a few kilometers of off-road riding, it's time for a break. This is the first impression we have of the spectacular Ethiopian landscape. Most of the country is made up of extensive high mountains. More than one-fourth of Ethiopia is at an altitude of more than 1,800 meters. Tegi, our Ethiopian friend, wants to show us something. A field of teff, the crop from which the traditional injera bread is made.
This is teff, little seeds. We make injera from this.
We are still heading for Alem Ketema. Our group is made up of 6 people on 5 motorcycles. First, there is Jan Peter and Wolfgang, the camera team. Then there is Rainer, who has already traveled Ethiopia on motorcycles several times, and Tegi, who rides as a passenger on Rainer's bike. Then Ramona and me. We are all riding BMW F800 GS bikes, except for Ramona, who rides a 650 series cross challenge. All our bikes have reserve fuel tanks, so we can travel long distances without needing to tank up. These motorcycles were specially prepared for the journey by Tourtech in Niedereschach, Germany. From the robust panniers and the specially tuned shocks to the comfortable seats and various special accessories. A trip like this is also a good chance to test equipment. Articles that don't perform well are modified or discontinued. But will our preparations be sufficient for this countryside? This is how a normal day starts at the kindergarten in Alem Ketema, where we had set up our tents the night before. We are allowed to pop in on a class. This kindergarten is more like a school prep, where the children learn reading, writing, arithmetic, and even English. The partner community of Alem Ketema in Germany, the town of Vaterstetten, near Munich, not only donates money to the project, but also sends volunteers to help out. The Vaterstetten kindergarten was set up in Alem Ketema in the year 2000. But this place is also known in connection with a different name. The famous Austrian actor and philanthropist Karl-Heinz Böhm set up an aid organization and assisted projects of many kinds. A monument to his memory is right in the center of town. Not far from Alem Ketema, the first coffee break of the day. I always enjoy the coffee. I think that's one of the reasons we came here. So we should try it everywhere and make sure it's really as good as they say. everyday scene in Ethiopia. Donkey, sheep, goats and cows on the road. People are returning from a marketplace. Then an incident that doesn't happen every day. An attack on our cameraman Jan Peter. He's able to avoid being gored by the bull by jumping off his motorcycle. Luckily, he isn't hurt.
I fell on my left side and that's it.
That's from the animal?
That's the one. And here too. He grazed me, here too.
Okay, that will only be some minor repairs and then we can continue.
Now I know why the suitcases are made of aluminum. So you can just hammer them back into shape when they get dented by a bull.
The night watchman of the hotel in Cambodia watched intensely as Jan Peter repairs his pannier. But maybe he's just waiting to get his hammer back. At any rate, I take care of the motorcycle's chains.
And early the next morning, we continue on in the direction of Lalibela. It's just before 6 p.m. We've been on our bikes all day, having set out at 7 a.m. Time for a break and a few photos of the sunset just outside of Lalibela. These kids are on their way home, but apparently it's more exciting to try to strike up a conversation than to just go home. They even unpack their school books to show us what they are learning, but none of them speaks any English. We have a lot of fun anyway.
Yes.
Giraffes?
Yes.
The next morning, we go off to an early start again, namely at the break of dawn, 5:30 a.m. A guide has promised to show us the famous churches in Lalibela.
The overview of Lalibela from here. Can you imagine the mountains surrounding the town? That we call them Lasta Mountains or Lasta Highland, okay? And also we have those churches which are built from the end of 11th century by King Lalibela. Can you imagine the churches we have in here? This is almost six churches we have around, which are built from one rock, one gigantic rock. Can you imagine? This was one solid rock, and they built the churches from top to bottom. So you can imagine the tools which they used to build the churches were like iron chisel and hammer. There was no any more technical instrument to build the churches. So you can...
Before leaving Lalibela, we fill our fuel tanks the African way, from barrels and buckets. We are still heading north. Next stop, the town of Aksum. From there we will ride into the Simien Mountains, the highest in Ethiopia. We reflect on everything we've seen so far. We can't help but think how very different it is than we expected. My expectations were entirely different about the whole trip. So far, everything has gone extremely well, to the point that I don't really even feel like I'm in the same Ethiopia we read about on the internet and hear about elsewhere.
A short break in the limited shade of a tree. It's not long before we have company. A car stops and a group of people join us. We quickly strike up a conversation and have to explain where we are from, where we are going, how we like Ethiopia. And I love it. It has changed a lot since my last visit. I was amazed that here, in the middle of nowhere, a car stops playing loud music and out pour I don't know how many people, and introduce themselves, hello, how are you, and want to know what we think of the country, our impressions, how we like Ethiopia, and whether we consider it an underdeveloped country, whether there's any progress. I think a lot has happened in the past 10 years. There used to be virtually no infrastructure at all. Now, You can ride on dirt roads similar to the ones in Namibia. You can ride nearly as fast as on the German Autobahn. The roads are in excellent condition. About 5 years ago, they started allowing girls to attend school, which I think is wonderful. Buildings are going up everywhere. About half of the people have mobile phones. So much is changing.
Heutzutage hat fast jeder Zweite ein Handy. Also es tut sich so einiges.
Time for a rest in a small village. We're waiting for Ramona and Herbert. The children and young people have gathered around us. Our visit is a major event here. One of the older girls is braiding Tegi's hair. Apparently, the girls here are experts. Many of them wear intricately woven hairdos. But as more time goes by, we're still waiting for Ramona and Herbert, until we finally learn that the two had a mishap not far from here.
Wolfgang, what happened? We're waiting for Herbert and Ramona.
Ramona's bike won't start. It looks bad.
We have to fix it?
Time for some maintenance.
We just adjusted the gear lever into position, but now the bike won't start. I don't know what the basic problem is. There was a spark for a second, but then it goes out. The kill switch, everything works. Now I've removed the starter. I connected it directly with the battery. The battery is not dead at all. But now we don't know where the problem is. It's either some relay or a conductor to a relay, the ignition switch or something else.
Thank you.
Problem solved?
No, I think we've just postponed the problem. Fact is, I spent a lot of time on the ignition switch. I had been bypassing it somehow. I don't have a clue. But it's running now. We've put it back together. Now we are going to reattach the tank. And then we can be on our way. But we didn't get far. After just a few kilometers, the bike broke down again. Now it's time to push all the way to the campsite. Not very much fun when the temperature is about 30 degrees Celsius.
No.
Just another 50 meters.
The next morning, our campsite is only ours till 6 a.m. Then people come here to get water for the nearby villages. Fortunately, we bought food and can make breakfast.
Chilies. Chili.
Rainer and Herbert are still messing around with the switch. As always, they have attracted a curious audience. The donkeys will have to bring the water back to the village on their own today. This is more exciting.
It works. Now it doesn't. Now it works again.
Here is where the loose contact is.
It's hard to pinpoint the problem. But that gives us plenty of time for a real breakfast. Spaghetti with tomato sauce and coffee.
So the sauce is warm too.
And now Herbert has figured out what the problem is. All he had to do was take the ignition switch completely apart.
Now it's working perfectly. One of the leads from this part was jammed. There was a plastic edge that hadn't been deburred properly and it was catching on his hold. And because of that, we had been shaking it loose again, until it finally broke off.
Dann hat man immer wieder dran gerüttelt, dann ist es losgegangen und dann hat man, also es war einfach verklemmt.
The switch is back in operation, after a few hours of diagnosis and repair. We are not far from Aksum, today's destination. On the way to Aksum, we see the town of Adwa down in the valley. This city is a reminder of Italy's misguided attempt to colonize Ethiopia. The decisive battle of Adwa took place in the year 1896. The Italian troops were defeated by the Ethiopian army under Emperor Menelik II. Ethiopia did not become an Italian colony. That evening in Aksum, we say goodbye to Tegi. She's flying back to Germany. What are you going to do? You're flying to Addis tomorrow and then party?
No more motorcycles.
No, I'll miss it. I have to fly back to Frankfurt.
Flying is almost as much fun as riding a bike. What did you like most about our tour?
Our team was the best thing about it.
Bidding farewell to Tegi is difficult for all of us. We all wish she would stay and continue traveling with us.
A new asphalt road leads us toward the Simien Mountains, but only a few kilometers of the road have been paved. The most common feature of the road to the mountains is its construction sites. But from time to time, we are rewarded with a view of the faraway mountains. Even in this hazy light, the Simien Mountains are spectacularly beautiful. Again and again, our progress is slowed by construction sites. Road construction is booming in Ethiopia as efforts are made to improve the country's infrastructure. Interestingly, it is primarily the Chinese government that is sending engineers and construction equipment. Eventually, we arrive in the town of Dibarak. Finally, I have an opportunity to repair Ramona's proper stand, which broke off on the road. I plan to extend it and weld on a plate. Lest there be a misunderstanding, the stand had been shortened because Ramona's chassis had been lowered a bit. So it's not really a material defect in the stand itself. We sawed it off, screwed it on and welded it, and the seam eventually broke. Stuff happens. We thought it was stable enough, but it wasn't. We quickly find a suitable metal pipe. I indicate where it needs to be cut. It's good that we are not left entirely to our own devices. Not many people speak English here. We have a new companion to interpret for us, who also knows his way around the Simien Mountains.
And I will remove, and then you can use this pipe.
Dani explains to the people from the workshop what I want the side stand to look like. As always, it doesn't take long before we have attracted a crowd of people. A few more finishing touches and the pipe should do the job. The pipe is tentatively attached to the stand. First, I want to see whether it's the right size. And it fits. Ramona's motorcycle has a proper side stand again.
Perfect. Fine. Yeah.
At our campsite in the Simien Mountains, we take care of a few other overdue maintenance jobs. The air filters are in need of a cleaning. This is a special foam filter from Australia, where they have a problem with very fine, very aggressive dust that quickly ruins the engines there. It was specially developed there and specially made in Australia for these BMW long-distance touring bikes.
Das ist doch noch mal eine Nummer für sich, was hier rauskommt.
It's nice to be able to take a day off. Getting here was strenuous enough. Taking care of the bikes, enjoying the sunshine and drinking tea is a good way for us to spend the day.
And we finally have a chance to see how the staple food injera is prepared. Injera is eaten with every meal in Ethiopia, morning, noon, and night. Teff, the grain used to make the dough, grows exclusively here in Ethiopia. The little bubbles in the dough are characteristic for injera. The flat breads are only cooked from one side and are ready as soon as they no longer stick to the pan. Our first foray into the mountains. Everywhere we look, we see grazing geladas, a local baboon species, indigenous to the Ethiopian highlands. They can only be found here. During the day, geladas forage for food, and they sleep in the rocks at night. They are herbivores and live off grass, seeds, and roots. Geladas live in small groups, but can band together in groups of up to 400 individuals. The view of the magnificent mountains is captivating, and we can also spot little villages in the valley below. We wonder what life is like for the people there.
No, just every day, every week on Saturdays, they come back through the small trail. No road at all, just to drive down to here. So the people every day just walk 7-8 hours to the market area. It's like, they will come to the market just to buy like maybe clothes or any goods, something like that. But they have their own farming. So they don't buy like crop. But they will come for different things, like silly things. Yeah.
We wonder whether this little boy group lives in one of the villages. Although roads are being built all over the country, they will probably never reach these little mountain villages. Is that a blessing or a curse? We don't know. The next morning, Jan Peter and I set out for Mount Ras Dashen. It's Ethiopia's highest mountain, 4,550 meters tall, but we can't go to the summit today. The area is closed off to protect the endangered ibexes that live here. Oh well, we can just enjoy the view from an altitude of 4,300 meters. Herbert didn't come with us. He stayed at the campsite to work on his clutch, which has been giving him trouble lately. Taking his clutch apart instead of joining us on the road is certainly not pleasant. He'll just have to be content to hear our stories.
Unfortunately, my concerns were not unfounded. The clutch gives out on us on the way back to Aksum. My bike can't move a meter. We'll have to improvise. Dani stops an overland bus and negotiates with the driver. Maybe we can get the bikes on the bus? As the crow flies, it's just 106 kilometers to Aksum. Will our idea with the bus work?
Barter,
I just peeked into the bus. We might be able to get the tank back in there, but it's too full for anything else. Besides, his clutch and brake smell worse than mine. I'm not sure I want to roll downhill in that thing. But first, everybody gets out of the bus, and some have a daring idea.
They want to put it on the roof. They want to strap it onto the roof. I don't know who is going to carry it up there.
He says they have enough people. Well, they assured me that if we want to put the motorcycle on the roof, there are about 50 strong young men. They'll be able to get it up there.
Up there?
No problem. I want to see this.
They say that's no problem? This I want to see.
And then the bus driver suddenly takes an interest in what might be wrong with the motorcycle. Ramona explains it, and little by little we begin to understand why we shouldn't put the motorcycle on the roof of the bus.
The reason why we can't take this bus is that it only goes to the next village. And from there, we would have to charter a different bus, which means we would be hoisting and lowering the bike 3 or 4 times. So let's just wait for the next one.
Because we don't know when the next bus is coming, we try something else. Dani tries to get us a truck from the bark. My clutch is definitely beyond of repair now, but I saw that coming. I think it was already pretty worn out from our tour to Mozambique last year. There was an incredible amount of deep sand in Mozambique and Swaziland. The engine hadn't clocked that many kilometers, but we probably should have replaced the clutch. Now it's done for. We have to load up the bike. We have to get to Axum, because we noticed 2 days ago that the clutch has about to go. We had a new one shipped to Addis. This clutch will be arriving in Axum tomorrow, so everything is gonna be all right. Ramona and I will load up our bikes. Dani will help us, while Rainer, Jan-Peter and Wolfgang will set out for Axum. Drive carefully. Now we are back in Axum. In the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Axum is considered the holy city, and the Ark of the Covenant is said to be contained in the Church of Holy Mary of Zion. A new clutch for my motorcycle arrives at the hotel early in the morning. In a plastic bag. I'm skilled at this now, having practiced already. I no longer worry about having to replace a clutch. It's a good thing there is a never-ending flow of coffee here at the hotel.
Coffee, please. And coffee for the mechanic also.
Okay.
He needs it very urgently.
It takes all my concentration to keep from mixing up the clutch discs. Fortunately, Ramona is helping me keeping track of them.
You stopped at 9.
I'm gonna count them all again. Yesterday, no, the day before, I forgot one. Maybe the sun-drenched garden of the hotel is a contributing factor. At any rate, the job is done in no time. So let's see what the bike says. Back to work, running like new, maybe better than you. It's an incredibly good feeling to know that the motorcycle is in good operating order again. After all, the hardest stretch of our tour lies before us. Our next destination is the Danakil Desert in eastern Ethiopia.
Once again, we have to traverse several hundred kilometers to reach our next destination. On the way, we conduct initial experiments in roasting coffee on our own, using a wide gas stove. In Hausen, we bid farewell to Dani, who is returning to the Singen Mountains. And we are getting closer and closer to the notorious Danakil Desert. This region has been called the cruelest place on Earth. What will we find there? The settlement of Be'er Aleh on the edge of the Danakil Desert. Probably the last place anyone will be serving us coffee. From here on, there are no more restaurants. The music videos on Ethiopian satellite TV seem like the last witches of civilization. Our heads are filled with all the things we've heard about the desert. Was it really such a good idea to come here? Well, there's no turning back now. Besides, they are roasting fresh coffee for us. Watching people prepare coffee in this country is always fascinating. Hearing how the coffee pops and crackles, seeing it change color, smelling the aroma as it slowly fills the entire room, a thoroughly sensuous experience. Maybe it's because of the time they invest in making coffee. Maybe the way we drink coffee in the Western world is doing the drink itself a disservice. Maybe we need to relearn what it means to be able to drink a cup of delicious coffee. And maybe we'll miss the smell of the incense that is burned during the coffee ceremony when we are back home in Germany. And didn't we want to be back on the road hours ago? But at the moment, we feel completely relaxed and at home here, in this little hut on the edge of the desert. When the coffee arrives and stands before us, Herbert says what we've all been thinking.
This is the last cup of coffee before the desert. No more gravel roads from now on. From here, we are down to serious business.
We are having yet another cup of coffee before going on. But eventually, we have to leave. Downhill at first, and the trek is easy to negotiate. And the temperature starts to rise. The Danakil is a lonely, infertile region. The average temperature here is above 50 degrees Celsius. And although the desert is not exactly on the beaten path for tourists, some do make the trek, like us. Maybe they come for the loneliness and expansiveness of the Danakil, or maybe because of the bizarre formations of its landscape, or its active volcanoes. Geologically speaking, the Danakil Depression is a very active place. It lies at the north end of the East African Rift. This region is one of the rare rift zones where tectonic plates push against each other, creating a faulted landscape. Three geologically active tectonic plates collide here. All three segments having been moving away from each other for millions of years, creating the Danakil Depression, which is more than 100 meters below sea level. The next day, we are on our way to the Dalol volcano. We are always in sight of our escort vehicles. No one ventures here without drivers who know their way around, a plentiful supply of water and food, and armed soldiers. The Danakil Desert is a pretty dangerous place. Dalol is not easily recognizable as a volcano. It's more like a hill that protrudes from the salt flats. This area has the highest annual average temperature in the world. A place like this makes it clear what's going on inside the earth. hot groundwater rises to the surface, dissolving minerals along the way. Then, the water evaporates, leaving behind mineral deposits that create bizarre shapes. Sulfur and various salts appear in a variety of colors. It's an extraordinary spectacle. One of our military companions has made himself comfortable in the shade. The Delol is just a few kilometers from the border with Eritrea. That's the official explanation for our armed escorts. The sun beats mercilessly from the sky. It's unbearably hot. Our GPS says we are just a little more than 100 meters below sea level. We urgently need to cool off. We need the wind of the road in our faces. Afternoon riding a bike through endless stretches of desert is an experience you don't soon forget. We don't return to the camp with the others. We want to set up our tents here and enjoy the desert night in solitude.
The next morning, back at the camp, Endark is the head of the troop accompanying us in the Danakil. Their days begin early. The most important task, ensuring everyone has enough water. Rainer stays in bed while Jan Peter makes his way to the corrugated metal shower. The camp is awakening. A long caravan of camels passes by on the road.
The good thing about the desert is you always have warm water.
Ramona and Herbert also encountered the caravan on their way back from their campsite out in the desert. Salt harvested in the Danakil is still transported by camel to this day.
We are heading south towards the Erta Ale volcano. And today, for the first time, we sense what it means to ride a bike through the Danakil Desert. There are no streets or roads. You just follow a track or a collection of tracks. And the desert is treacherous. The ground is dry and easy to travel 1 minute, then wet and muddy the next.
Thank you.
Then, the sand becomes deeper again, and you have to navigate between bushes. The desert demands complete concentration. We come to a halt in the far reaches of the desert. One of the escort vehicles is missing. Worse than that, it's the car carrying the food. That's not a good idea. No dinner, no breakfast. Not a good idea. Rainer and the crews in the other vehicles are also concerned. We wait and worry. No sign of them anywhere. Wolfgang was the last to see the car.
I had gotten stuck in the muddy patch. The guys came by with the car and helped me out, then got stuck themselves. I kept driving and I can't really say whether they got out or not. My problem was that I was trying to catch up with you guys. I just trusted they would be able to free themselves on their own. Now we have to go back and see whether they're on their way.
Ist im Moment ein Problem, weil ich habe natürlich versucht hinter euch herzukommen. Ich habe auch darauf vertraut, dass die es von allein schaffen, da rauszukommen. Jetzt müssen wir sehen, ob sie auch hierher unterwegs sind.
Even odometers don't seem to tell the truth here. And we are hungry.
According to my odometer, we've got about another 30 kilometers to our destination for today, which means about 20 to lunch. But according to the guys with the car, it's a total of 100 kilometers altogether instead of 80. So that's another 35 to lunch. That means we would have to ride another 3 hours at this speed.
Finally, the second car shows up again, and we can continue on our way. Once again, we experience that things are completely different out here in the desert. Again and again, we get stuck in the sand. A heavily laden bike can't make it out of here on its own.
Not push, lift up, lift up.
We have been invited to an audience with the local chief. The people living in the Danakil Desert are called the Afar. They also hold administrative authority in the region. We are all grateful to be able to rest in the shade of the hut. And Doc has to announce our presence. Anyone wanting to visit the volcano must first register, so the Afar civil servants always know how many tourists there are in the area they are responsible for.
Now he's arranging to give us 2 policemen and 1 guide who is going to lead us to the volcano, because we have to know the road to the volcano, and they know, because they live around here, they know the road, so he's going to give us the leader to reach to the volcano. And the other thing is, it depends on our choice. Also, he's going to give us 3 camels. And the other thing is, since around here is a border of Eritrea, criteria, and we have to be protected by the soldiers in case of anything. They don't want to take any kind of risk for the tourists, so they are going to give us two policemen and one who is going to show us the road. And before that, we already brought the letters and the entrance letter with your with everybody's tourist number, passport number, name, and nationality. I already bring that, so he's going to check. He's going to cross-check, and after that, he's going to give us a soldier, and we'll go.
After I've posed a few questions to satisfy my curiosity, the Afar chief turns the tables and starts asking me questions.
Can you tell me about yourself a little bit?
My name is Wolfgang.
He means it. Now I have to give an account of myself. Driving in sand is pretty fun because you're kind of slipping around with a back wheel. It's kind of like surfing, but also very exhausting. Just now I had to set my bike back upright twice. Got stuck in a rut behind the truck, which also couldn't dig out. And now here we are for some refreshment. Like you can see, this is no water. It's all the real thing.
At any rate, we all kind of expected it would all be a little easier, and the 20 kilometers they promised yesterday actually turned out to be 40.
Wirklich, also nicht bestätigten Gerüchten geglaubt werden darf, sind es jetzt noch 20 Kilometer bis zum.
But I don't believe anything anymore. The temperature at the moment is 32 degrees and the tracks lead through fine sand. Who is looking forward to climbing the volcano?
Ask me again this evening. Right now I don't have enough energy to climb up there, but maybe I will. We're drinking some Coke now. Herbert's making a lunch packet. That gives us strength.
Fortified, we get back on the track. But it hasn't gotten any easier since lunchtime. Near the volcano, the ground is no longer sandy, but rocky. At least we can get better traction here. In the distance, Erta Ale volcano awaits us. It's 5:30 in the morning of the next day. At sunrise, we find ourselves on the edge of the Erta Ale crater. Erta Ale is one of the few volcanoes in the world with an active lava lake. That didn't keep us from pitching our tent next to the crater. Rises from the crater. The air is filled with sulfur fumes, and yet you don't want to take your eyes off this unique spectacle. We humans can only witness a few fleeting moments of the Earth's long history. The Danakil Desert is one of the few places where you can do just that. We turn back in silence. There's not much to say, having witnessed the violence of what's underneath the Earth's crust. And this is as far as our journey takes us. From here, we head back to Addis Ababa. The return trip to the capital takes us through the southern Afar region. We give ourselves time to visit Valerie Browning. Valerie Browning has been living here for the past 30 years. Untiringly, she dedicates herself to the human rights and living conditions of the Afar nomads who live here. We are on our way to a desert village that is one of her projects. The Afar nomads usually have very little contact with the outside world due to their nomadic way of life. There's no infrastructure here, no schools, roads, or doctors. The Afar live in accordance with their ancient traditional ways.
Oh, I'm hot. Huh? Owl. Hmm?
We visit a young family far out in the desert. I've never seen a home like this from the inside before.
So, yeah. And the mats are woven but from, what do you call it, dry palm leaf. We call that unga.
Unga.
Onga Lito, Mantu.
Difficult to get it.
Somewhere from here.
Valerie encourages the young woman to tell us about her life here.
She said collecting water in an animal skin, storing stuff in an animal skin, and I'll show you how they cook the bread in the oven, the hole in the ground. That's all from ancient.
Grinding grain twice a day is a normal part of everyday life. They bake bread twice each day.
It's working really good.
Yeah, but I mean, it's pretty hard. It's back-breaking, hand-breaking. It make people, some women, pregnant women, miscarry doing it. It's very, I mean, they've got to grind grain, take them 2 hours, 3 hours, twice a day.
Asia
has got the animal skin on her back with water in it. Have a look. Asia.
Yeah, turn.
Asia, me. Up our refrigerator. Keeps the water cool, keeps the water nice, actually.
Aisha has spread a wet cloth over the leather sack to keep the water cool. Valerie calls it an Afar refrigerator. With Valerie's help, a well has been dug close by. The women used to have to walk a long way to get water. With projects like this, Valerie is changing the customs of the Afa people.
Are you happy about the well?
And Valerie translates for me.
He
said, yes, it was terrific.
Ha!
Thank you.
Thank you.
So before you had the well, how far or how long, how many hours did you have to walk to find water? He said we used to go for 9 hours walking for water before. Yeah, we used to get up early in the morning. He said we go, we're hungry on the way, we're thirsty and it's very hard. She said 9 hours we were going to get with the water, but now we got it.
Five weeks in Ethiopia lie behind us. What we've seen here was much more than we had ever expected. A country so fascinating, so mysterious, so unique. Coffee is a good reason to come to Ethiopia, but surely not the only one.